it's one of the most iconic sites in the Valley of the Sun. The famous Hole in the Rock. That magnificent, holy red butte created millions of years ago that was shaped and carved out by eons of erosion at the center of Papago Park. If you're looking for great outdoor recreation just minutes from downtown, then look no further. There are several acres of stock fishing lagoons surrounded by dozens of species of wildlife. There's also some highly rated climbing, hiking, and biking trails for all skill levels. 35 miles northwest of downtown Phoenix is a recreation lover's dream come true. With more than 23,000 acres of beautiful Sonoran desert and clear blue waters, Lake Pleasant Regional Park is a sportsman and women's paradise. What's up, everybody? I'm Mike Easley, and on this episode of Trail Mix, our roads lead to my hometown. Welcome to Phoenix! Here at Papago Park, we'll take a look at the short but beautiful hike that will lead you to one of the very best views of the city's skyline in the Valley of the Sun. Plus, hiking along the Wild Burrow Trail at Lake Pleasant, where we'll meet some of our four-legged creatures who have been here since the Spanish came to Arizona. Later, sailing in the desert? Believe it or not, it does exist, and it's pretty spectacular. We'll show you where to get your sail on. You ready? Oh, you know I'm ready. Trail Mix starts right now. For a lot of hikers and explorers not familiar with our urban desert, getting to the infamous Hole in the Rock is like being in a strange new world.
Oh my God, it's awesome.
It's a short, fairly easy trail, perfect for families, or for those who want to impress out-of-town visitors. A trip here is special. You can spend the entire day in the Arizona sunshine, just in awe of this sandstone spectacle straddling two big cities.
We were actually here visiting the zoo, and as we looked up and pulled into the parking lot, we looked up and we saw the mountain, and we saw people that were inside of the mountain and said, hey, it looks like an awesome thing to do once we finish the zoo. So we just drove over, and this was a pretty nice experience for us.
And once you get to the base right here, you're really not that far from the top. Phoenix is jam-packed full of epic views, gorgeous hikes, and striking landscapes that are just minutes from our homes. But this inner city wonder is unrivaled.
To me, I think it's like you're facing your fears over heights. Like, some people are afraid of heights, and
me,
I was, myself, so was my mom. And I'm like, come on, it's not that scary, it's like really, really cool. And I went there and I took like pictures and put on Instagram, Facebook, all that stuff. I'm like, yeah, I'm in a rock.
All right, y'all, we finally made it around the butte. Now from here, we're gonna go up the back entrance of Hole in the Rock. The views are only gonna get better from here. Thousands of hikers from here and around the world walk where ancient Hohokam Indians used to walk. They lived all around this area thousands of years ago, and a lot of history has come to pass here.
There's been a lot of research done. This whole area in and around Papago Park was clearly a site for indigenous peoples over the years. On the top of Hole in Rock, there's a hole. So we see the hole right here going this way, but at the very top, there's a hole as well. And on the solstice days, the sun shines and casts shadows down in certain areas. It ended up being a solar observatory.
It's a beautiful topography and landscape. Right when we got out of the airport and we were driving through, it kind of takes your breath away. It's just like cactus. I've never seen a cactus before. And everything is just so pretty. I love it here. It looks like another planet. When we were biking over here, I kind of just came out of nowhere. And then you get up there and you're looking over the whole city and the whole view of everything, and it's gorgeous.
Here, the round mounds of terracotta colored sandstone, which are all over the park, are pockmarked with Swiss cheese-like holes. The appearance alone can bring out the kid explorer and every hiker that comes here, because a lot of them want to keep climbing to see what's over the next holy hill.
I was terrified once I got up there. I was like shaking. Someone asked if they needed to hold their arm. I am afraid of heights, but you know, once we got up there, I was like, oh my God, this is so beautiful. So I'm glad I did it. I'm glad we did it.
Once you get to the top, you have to take in this incredible view, especially on a sunny, warm day in Phoenix.
This is the moment you have been waiting for. The views of the city are just amazing. And overall, the hike isn't too tough. It's truly a great way to either start or end a day.
I can see why this is a point of pride for Phoenix. I'm proud I made it up here. I'm a proud Arizonian, and I can say, nowhere else are you gonna find something like Hole in the Rock in the middle of the city.
We're here at the Deer Valley Petroglyph Preserve. It's located in Northwest Phoenix, and we're known for having petroglyphs on over 500 boulders here at the preserve on a visitor trail that gives access to view these petroglyphs.
More than 1,500 Native American petroglyphs have been found on this hillside, the largest concentration in Phoenix. This rock art is as old as 6,000 years and as young as 200, and is the star attraction.
We don't know what the petroglyphs mean, but there have been many interpretations over the years from different archaeologists. Some are kind of notable. We have the spiral image here. We have squiggles as well. Some of the interpretations for that is they could mean water. It could be an indication of water. We also have a lot of animal images here. So we have deer, bighorn sheep images, and that could possibly be indicative of game that could have been hunted here for food.
While their meanings may not be fully understood, we do know that this was a major corridor to the north.
They would travel waterways a lot. Skunk Creek at the time was a waterway. It had water in it. So they would have been following these resources as a means of either living or gathering resources for food, for tools. A lot of our waterways do run north to south, and so they would have traveled along those.
Bailey, what do we have going on over here? Are these like tools? Like, what's happening?
That's exactly what they are. These are manos and metates. They were used by cultural traditions, and they're actually still used by cultures today for grinding food. The Hohokam, back when they were here, you know, about 1,000 years ago, they would have grinded mesquite beans, corn, into a nice fine flour, and then you can make it into any sort of cakes, patties. Probably more notable today is, you know, tortillas.
Oh.
And yeah, these are used in many cultures today. It's, you know, they're not just an old tool. They're still very prominent and present. And the cultures that were here actually would have made manos and metates from our boulders that we have here.
So you said manos and metates. Which one is which? I want to know. Yeah, can you show me real quick?
Yeah. So this is a mano, and mano means hand in Spanish. So pretty, yep.
Okay.
Pretty, you know, simple to know, mm-hmm. and pretty identifiable. Use it in your hand. And this is the metate, which means large flat stone. And what you would do is you would break up your mesquite beans, for example, and you'd place them on the metate. And at first you would actually crush them with the mano, get them, break them up into smaller pieces.
Okay, we're grinding a little bit.
Yeah, we're doing some mashing, yep. And then once you get them broken up into smaller pieces, then what you would do is you take the mano and then you'd really start grinding it back and forth. And that's how you get your fine powder.
The preserve, it's just 2 miles off I-17 and could be considered the first freeway through this area.
There really wasn't anything here.
Arizona State University's School of Human Evolution and Social Change has protected and preserved this site for nearly 30 years. Celeste Scott is the museum's assistant director.
I believe when they did the walkthrough and actually started doing the site for the dam, they were found. Back in 1994, when this was all being created, this was the result of research that was done by Dr. J. Simon Bruder back in 1980, when the petroglyphs were discovered and the adobe dam was being built. The Army Corps of Engineers and the Flood Control District of Maricopa County were building the adobe dam project. So from that research and her work in discovering, documenting, and interpreting the petroglyphs here, they went ahead and built the museum and the trail to talk about and present this to the public, to just give them information and the experience of seeing something like this that was made, you know, so many years ago.
Archaeologists have concluded that three groups were here.
The Western Archaic, Hohokam, and Patayan, and they were very distinct from each other, the Western Archaic being the oldest, the Hohokam, they're the most notable here in the Phoenix area, and the Patayan, who kind of lived around the same time as the Hohokam. It's a cultural site because each group of people that lived here and still live here, they have a culture, they have a way of life, they have, you know, tools that they made, they have pottery, jewelry, and it's so distinct to who they were as a group. And so we want to identify those people as their way of life, who they are as people and as a group.
There's certain restrictions that we have out of respect for the petroglyphs and the cultures that from the past that made the petroglyphs. It's a little more protected. This has been here for a very long time. And what we attempt to do here at the preserve, when we talk about protect, is to just keep it clean and safe and free from vandalism and damage. And many times there are a lot of petroglyph sites in Arizona that are open to the public. We try and encourage folks that when they do go out to other areas in the state to just be mindful of where they are, to be careful and to keep it clean and to be respectful on these types of spaces that they do have meaning and they've meant something and they still mean something today.
Lake Pleasant is the largest man-made lake in Phoenix and Scottsdale. Now, I'm a little bit biased, I grew up around here, so I love the lake. People visiting the lake for the first time might do a double take of sorts when they first arrive. It is a lake in the middle of the desert, filled with fun activities for everyone to enjoy.
Back in 1927, the Carl Pleasant Dam was built, hence the creation of the lake. It was filled by the Agua Fria River and was about a quarter of the size it is today. In 1935, the dam underwent a retrofit, and in 1964, it was renamed the Waddell Dam. Central Arizona Project built an aqueduct to divert Colorado River water to the lake, and that's when Lake Pleasant became a reservoir. In the early 1990s, construction of the new Waddell Dam quadrupled the surface area of the lake and submerged the old dam beneath its waters. Today, Central Arizona Project stores water at Lake Pleasant during low demand periods like during the wintertime. Then, it releases water to municipal and tribal customers during the summer when demand is high. When most people from back east think of Phoenix, images of cactus and desert most likely come to mind. I bet the idea of marinas and navigating sailboats across blue water doesn't really add up in their imagination. That is, until you meet Tom.
Tom?
Hey,
good, good, all right, I'm ready.
Some sailing, you ready? We've been teaching sailing to people for over 30 years here in the middle of the desert.
In the middle of the desert is, of course, Lake Pleasant. Tom Erickson owns the sailboat shop at the Scorpion Bay Marina there, and has helped a lot of desert dwellers like me on their lake legs.
Learning the parts of the boat are really important, and learning the points of sail is another very important part of understanding how to make the boat take you across the lake or around the world. A sailboat only does four things. It can either head up, sail closer to the wind, bear away, sail away from the wind, or it can tack through the wind, or can jibe through the wind.
Tom's been sailing ever since he was a kid, growing up in, wait for it.
I grew up right here in the Phoenix area, went to high school here, and Actually, when we were in high school, we used to come up here to Lake Pleasant, go sailing.
As we make our way towards the open water, I start to get those big white sails ready to go.
Whee! The wind gets on the other side of the sail and it fills it up. And now we're going in the other direction on the same wind.
Oh, I get it. Okay, wind power.
Well, we're balancing the forces of the wind in the sails against the forces of the water on the hull and the rudder. And if you think about an airplane, it's got two wings. Well, we've got an airplane with one wing underwater and it has control surfaces and one wing up in the air, that's the sails, main and jib. And the force of the wind against the differential pressure of the water actually makes the boat go forward. This handle goes in here.
Okay.
Crank that, see how it pulls the line?
Yeah.
See how it pulls the sail up?
I do.
We're gonna be doing that a lot.
After hoisting the sails and catching some wind for a while, Tom actually lets me steer the boat.
Well, I'm figuring it out. I'll take that.
The wind is invisible, so it's a challenge to figure out how to make the boat go. And you've got to understand what the wind is doing. You've got to understand how it interacts with your sails. And once you get it in there, it'll just fill your whole day up with fun and enjoyment.
It's hard to concentrate when gliding across the water is so much fun.
Some people think it's unusual, but then people who have experienced sailing know that you're just harnessing the wind. Right now, the Valley of the Sun is about 80% people from out of state. And a lot of those people sailed wherever they came from, whether it was Minnesota or someplace. They move out here and they don't realize that there is sailing in the desert. There's a couple of very active sailing clubs.
There's a pure rush when I realize I'm harnessing the wind. There's power in it. And then it occurs to me, sometimes, a lot of the times, the wind wins. But when it calms down, and I'm breathing in the air, looking up at the full sails, coasting across the blue, I begin to see and understand why Tom spent so many years on the water, striving always to keep the wind at his back.
A sailboat works in harmony with Mother Nature, because you're balancing those forces. A power boat is trying to overcome the forces of Mother Nature, and that's why it pounds so much, that's why it's so rough, and it's so noisy. I really prefer working with Mother Nature and having her just rock you gently. Some people will almost feel like it's meditation when you're out there on the water. It can take you across the lake, or it can take you around the world. It's up to you how far you want to go.
If ever there was a season to hike the desert near Lake Pleasant, spring would have to be it. Bright yellow brittlebush and other colorful wildflowers grow alongside the giant saguaros on hills up and down the trails here this time of year.
There are some beautiful vistas here, really beautiful view. The flowers are out right now, so I would urge people to consider coming up here, even if they don't have a boat or a kayak or something like that.
But we're not here for the desert flowers, although they are plentiful and amazing. Lake Pleasant is known for having amazing hiking trails. This trail in particular is known as Prime Burrow Country. Today, we are hiking the Wild Burrow Trail. And if we're lucky, we might even spot a few pesky mules.
Hikers and bikers can start at the trailhead by going up a slight, worn incline and up a lush desert hill. Then, you wind around the hill and across a road to get towards the sparkly blue lake. In the first couple miles, you'll zigzag around a few coves and then take in some views of the lake. and the people who find their zen there.
Probably the combination of the water activities and the activities you can do on shore sets Lake Pleasant apart, certainly from the other regional parks in the Maricopa County system. It's the only one that has a substantial body of water, so I like to think of it as the best of both worlds.
As you make your way up and down the trail, you can look out over some lovely views of this shiny crystal lake. With the desert, mountains, and saguaros in the foreground and background, the colors are just stunning. Blues, greens, and lots of yellows this time of year. And then, maybe, you might hear them before you see them. The rogue, thick little donkeys roam around in little packs or alone. But if you do happen to run into them, it's best to remember they are wild.
Ranger DaCosta, I've seen a lot of burros out here today. What's the history of the burros here at Lake Pleasant?
Yeah, the North American continent had a lot of equines during the last ice age. And after the ice age came to an end, the equines went extinct in North America. And the Spanish reintroduced them here beginning in the 16th century with the arrival of Coronado and Cortez and others. And that was mostly horses, but burros came into the mix as well. And the species that we see out here are mostly ones that originated in North Africa. They were brought here from about the 1860s onward as pack animals for the mines in the area, mostly gold, copper, silver, lead. And as the mines began to close down, the burros were just let go. And they've been out here in the mountains reproducing. And the ones that are here today are their descendants of the original pack animals.
How many burros do you estimate are out here?
I would estimate in this immediate area, I was told about 800.
Whether you run into some burros or not along the Wild Burro Trail, the lake views alone and desert scenery are enough to draw you in.
Close to our campsite, we're a little north from here, and we wanted to do some hiking and Googled it and found this, and it's beautiful.
We looked at the lake and we figured it'd be a nice place to hike and look at the scenery and see saguaro cactus.
There's lots of desert, sky, and water to see here at Lake Pleasant Regional Park if you choose to hike here. But perhaps the best thing about coming here to hike is that you can always come back for more or try to venture out to play on the water. Either way, it's going to be a very good day at the lake.